shown us that the classical and quantum free energies and average energies give the same result. You have a question?
Sorry.
Yes.
So when I was doing the assignment, after the problem, I was having a problem to compute CP.
You were having problems computing CP?
CP.
Oh, CP.
Yeah.
Yes. So how do you compute CP?
The formula I knew, but I couldn't apply it because it's the formula where it works for integrals.
So okay. So fundamentally, the problem is that here there is no volume dependence of anything, right? So whether you change, you do you give heat at constant volume or heat at constant pressure, it's the same thing, because the system is confined by the harmonic oscillator. So it doesn't matter what the volume of the thing is. The pressure is zero. Okay, there is no pressure. If you imagine you have harmonic oscillators, bunch of harmonic oscillators here, okay, and the volume is the walls of the room are very, very far away, then it doesn't matter whether you change the volume or not, right? If we wanted to put the system in a volume, we should have in the integral that our friend did in the classical partition function, you should have limited the integrals to minus L half and L half, for example, in dQ. Okay? So if this, if L is, so, and then here you have, what did we have? M omega square divided by 2 times beta times Q square. Okay, so this is, let me write it as e to the minus Q square divided by 2 times sigma Q square. Okay, if L is much larger than sigma Q, then I can extend this integral to infinity and there is no L dependence. Okay, so there is no dependence of the partition function on the volume of the system if my system is confined. And therefore, whether you're doing transformation at constant volume, constant pressure, assuming the pressure is zero, you should get the same result. What was the formula that you wanted to apply?
That one was like integrals. It was CP.
For CP? Which one?
CP equals to CV plus some gamma.
Yeah, alpha of dV by dt at constant entropy. It was a very complicated one. I think CP is equal to R.
Yeah, okay. Okay, because of the constant entropy thing.
Yes.
Okay. All right. I just wanted you to give an argument why CP and CV should be equal. I didn't want to go all the way to the... Sorry, I should have said it explicitly. So, again, if there is no volume dependence in the partition function, then whether you think it's a constant volume or not constant volume doesn't really matter. But you're right, I think that the way of doing the calculation with the entropy, computing the entropy, that's kind of complicated. Okay. So you see, this sigma Q is what? Let's see, what sigma? So sigma Q square is 1 over beta m omega squared. So this actually becomes large when the temperature becomes pretty small. When the temperature, so this is kbt squared by m of the square. So it becomes large when the temperature becomes large, which, you know, means that the particle can actually go all the way to the top. But typically this thing is meters, and these objects will give you something like micrometers. So, okay. So let me, okay, if I rewrite this thing here, that our friend has written in a more compact form. I get that U, internal energy, is H bar omega. So for this lecture and also next couple of lectures, what we're going to do is we're going to practice computing partition function for quantum systems. A good check is always to do the same calculation for the corresponding classical system, and if you can do the calculation exactly in the quantum system, we take h bar going to zero limit, or, you know, h bar going to zero if you put h bar, you know, high temperature, as I was saying before, and get the two things must agree, okay? So as a check on the quantum mechanical calculation, you should take quantum mechanical calculation, send h bar to zero, you should get the classical calculation. We prove that in general for any v of q, but, you know, this needs to be done. So, so h bar omega and h bar omega divided by 2 times cotangent, hyperbolic cotangent of beta h bar omega. Okay. So when beta goes to infinity, temperature goes to zero, this thing goes to one, and we have u over m is h bar omega divided by 2. The classical result, we said it's linear in t, and the quantum is always like this. Okay? And the specific heat is the derivative of this thing with respect to the temperature. So here it's zero. And then goes to the value n kb. Why do we have this thing here? More or less, which temperature scale is this at which these two curves, this curves becomes linear?
Room temperature?
No, 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 no. The, I mean, in terms of the constants of our problem.
S plus omega.
Why is that? Because h bar omega is, so we have a discrete set of levels, and the gap is h bar omega. The specific heat is measuring the number of degrees of freedom that we excite when we at that temperature. The number of degrees of freedom that are active at that temperature. So we put the energy in, and this can take energy. These degrees of freedom can take energy. If we are at a very low temperature, then all our particles are going to be in the ground state. And if we give energy which is less than h bar omega, we're not going to excite the first excited state. Okay? So these temperatures, the first excited state is very up in the spectrum. So, but once we go to temperatures which are much larger than H bar omega, then this thing here is blurred. We don't see any more single levels. We see kind of a continuum. Okay? And therefore we go back to the classical result. So for temperatures much larger than H bar omega, well, divided KB. I always put KB equal to 1. For temperature much larger than H bar omega divided by KB, I don't see any more the discrete levels. And the classical result should work. Okay? In general, in any problem we have, when we measure the specific heat, when you increase the temperature, sometimes the specific heat has this kind of jumps, like this here, for example. So it's something, 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 and then jumps to something else. Okay. With that, not the phase transition, I'm not talking about the phase transition. But sometimes, for example, there are different energy scales that you activate in the system. So for example, when you have a molecule which can have also a moment of inertia, rotating. So if the temperature is sufficiently high, it's low such that the molecule stays in the ground state, then you're not going to see the effect of these degrees of freedom in the specific heat. You're just going to see ideal gas particles moving. When the temperature is increased beyond the gap to the first excited level in internal degrees of freedom, you're also going to see those. Okay, so the specific heat jumps to a new value, which measures the new number of degrees of freedom. And again, and again, and again. Okay? So, this is kind of important, and it's quite general. Okay? Let's do another example of partition function. This is actually pretty important. It's paramagnetism. So, paramagnetism is the effect in which you have a gas or a substance in general. You apply magnetic field and this substance magnetizes. You turn off the magnetic field and the substance goes back to being not magnetized. Okay, this is called paramagnetic. There are other examples in which you turn on the magnetic field, the substance magnetizes, and then you turn off the magnetic field and the substance does not go to zero magnetization. This is called ferromagnetism. There are even stranger things in which is a situation in which you turn on the magnetic field and the substance magnetizes in the opposite direction. This is called diamagnetism. Okay. So in general, the energy, the internal energy of the particles for paramagnetism is there is some magnetic moment times the magnetic field HI. Okay? So this is the direction of H. Magnetic moments mu. The So the only thing which is important is the angle between mu and h. Okay? So let's call this theta I, and we have minus mu times h, sum over I of cosine of theta I. What's the partition function? The partition function for one single particle, okay, then we take the power n if you want n particles, is the integral over the angles of e to the beta mu h cosine of theta. Now, the integral over the angles is what? The integral over the sphere, okay? Spherical coordinates, except the radius. So let's write it the omega and the total integral of the omega is what? 4 pi, okay? It's 2 pi in for the circle, it's 4 pi for the sphere. It's always convenient to write the partition function. So you know, these constants here are not kind of important for a partition function, because in the end, we always want derivatives of logarithms of the partition function. So when you have a logarithm of something which is defined times a constant, then, you know, this thing just is an irrelevant constant, except for computations of entropy. Okay? But the entropy is important, because the entropy is a constant. That's why sometimes we put one over n factorial, that's why sometimes... And if we want to compare with the proper quantum mechanical calculation also for the entropy, we have to do in such a way that also the constants of entropy are properly computed. Okay, so it's good to keep this thing here. So d phi is d omega is d phi divided by 4 pi, we see, and d phi goes from 0 to 2 pi. Phi is this angle here, and then we have d cos theta, and cos theta goes from minus 1 to 1 e to the beta mu h cos theta. Okay, so this is 1/2 integral minus 1 and 1 dx e to the beta mu hx is equal to 1/2 beta mu h e to the beta mu h minus e to the minus beta mu h. Okay? Good. This is hyperbolic sine of beta mu h divided by beta mu h. What is the expectation value of mu x? Now, assuming that h is parallel to z, the expectation value of mu x is, so mu x first of all is mu sine theta cosine phi. The expectation value of this thing is the partition function, and then we have the integral in d phi d cos theta divided by 4 pi, then this object here, mu sine theta cos phi, and then e to the beta mu h cos theta. What's this? Speak up. What did you say?
Integral over 5
is just 0. Exactly. because there is sine phi. Cos phi. So the integral of d phi will be zero. So we might even not do the integral over d theta. Okay, so this is zero. Why is this zero physically? Because the system has a symmetry, right? We have put H, so we broke the full rotational symmetry, but we are left with an SO2 symmetry. Okay? So we had SO3, the entire sphere. We put a field, we broke one axis, we are left with rotations around this axis. Okay? And so any quantity which is not invariant under this symmetry will average to zero. Physically, what does it mean? That the chaotic motion of the particles is such that is isotropic with respect to this phi. So it's likely to find the particle in pointing in this direction as it is pointing in the opposite direction. So for the same reason, the average of mu y will be zero. But now for mu z, now it's different. Mu z will be just integral d phi d cos theta 4 pi mu times cos theta, no phi dependence, e to the beta mu h cos theta divided by the partition function. And this is hyperbolic cotangent of beta mu h minus 1 over beta mu h. Okay? And if I plot this thing, times mu, sorry. Actually, let me. So if I plot as a function of temperature. Let me put it as a function of beta mu h. I plot mu z over mu. Hyperbolic cotangent of the argument is a pole when the argument is zero. So it was like 1 over the argument, but this is cancelled by this thing. So we are left with the other terms. The first of which is linear in x. So you have something like this. And then it saturates to which value?
1.
This is, I know, the physics of this is that when the temperature is very high, beta is very small, the system is blind to the external magnetic field. Okay? That just doesn't care. There's too much energy in the system for the magnetic field to have any effect. But when the temperature decreases, beta increases, the magnetization starts saturating and more or less saturates at more or less when this one is over the one. So beta mu h is more or less one. So meaning that the temperature of the magnetic field, if you want, at which we get saturation was like kb T over the magnetic moment. Okay? Now, Now, in the quantum, world, mu I is proportional to G E divided by 2mc times the angular momentum, which is an operator, okay, of the particle I. Oh, okay, we're just computing with just one part. So, because G is the Landeggi factor, it's just a number, it's a dimensionless number which depends on the internal structure of the atom. But the important thing is that now we have the internal angular momentum, and so L square is J times J plus 1, and this defines the number of degrees the number of levels we have in our angular momentum motion. Okay, the representation of SU2, which is realized by this object. Okay? Now, MZ will be mu, right? We call this mu, which is G times the Bohr's magneton, times LZ. And LZ takes J plus 1 values from minus J to J. Now, when I take the trace, it's convenient to take the trace in which basis?
The basis of the analysis.
Which are the basis of M, right? So this trace of something becomes the sum over M that goes from minus J to J of the basis JM. Something, something, JM. Okay. Now let me actually, in order to do the, let me add this constant here, which is just such that the trace of the identity is 1. And let me just divide by the number of levels, which is 1 over 2j plus 1. Now if I take the trace of the Hamiltonian plus beta mu H M, LZ, 1 over 2J plus 1 becomes 1 over 2J plus 1, sum for M that goes from minus J to J of V to the beta mu H M. Now, if I define again x beta mu h, this is 1 over 2j plus 1 e to the 2j plus 1 divided by j times. Oh, sorry. Let me put the j here. Because the classical limit, the same classical limit will be when mu j, so j goes to infinity, and mu j goes to the to a classical mu classical here. Okay. This is hyperbolic sine of 1 plus 1 divided by 2j times x divided by 2j hyperbolic sine of x divided by 2j. When you take j to infinity here, you get the classical partition function. And you, okay, so therefore you get all the same results here. One important thing for paramagnetism is susceptibility. The susceptibility, now the magnetization, the total magnetization of the system along the z-direction is n times the average magnetization of a single path. And if you now take this when h goes to zero, you will see that this is n mu squared divided by 3 kBt times h plus order h cubed. Why is this an odd function of h? Because if I reverse the magnetic field, the magnetization reverses. This is an easy check on calculation to check that you've read. If this had started with the h squared, it would have been a problem. If this contained an h squared, it would have been a problem because it would mean that it was an analytic function. So the magnetization, the susceptibility chi is dmz by dh when h goes to zero, and it's inversely proportional, there's some constant divided by c, inversely proportional to the temperature, which is called, this is called Curie's law. If you do the calculation with the quantum mechanical system, you'll find exactly the same thing. So this small magnetization property is the same. Okay. Now, the susceptibility diverges at zero temperature. Sometimes, however, it diverges at finite temperature. So this is Curie's law. At zero temperature. Sometimes it diverges at some other temperature. And this is a signature of a phase transition. A paramagnet does not have other phases. There is no order in the system. So the only place where it could diverge is at zero temperature. It was not guaranteed to diverge at zero temperature, but such it is. Now let me discuss another thing which makes sense when you have a discrete spectrum. Hence the concept of negative temperatures. Okay? So, the partition function is the sum over energy levels of e to the minus beta ER. Sometimes these energy levels start somewhere in the ground state and go up to infinity. For example, a particle in a box, harmonic oscillator. You start at zero and go up to infinity. Sometimes, as in the case we have seen, when you have an angular momentum, you have a representation of the algebra which is finite dimension. Representation of the algebra of P and Q is not finite dimensional. Okay, so it's infinite dimensional. So the Hilbert space has to be infinite dimensional. Representation of SU2 algebras can be finite dimensional. So systems which have a spin might have a few levels. The simplest case, well, the simplest case is which you have a scalar representation which has only one level, but that's too simple. There's nothing happening there. And the second simplest case is when you have two levels, so spin 1/2. At that point, you have just two levels. Magnetization equal minus 1/2, magnetization equal 1/2. At that point, there is not, see, if the Hamiltonian is, I don't know, H dot S, H Z S Z, let's say. Then there is nothing wrong in taking, in computing this sum for negative beta. Okay? So Q1 becomes an analytic function of beta. But what does it mean? So, let's take this case here. So Q1 is m equals minus 1/2 of e to the beta. Let me write it like this, 2 epsilon m. And this is 2 times hyperbolic cosine of beta epsilon. All right, the free energy is minus n, kBT, logarithm of 2 times hyperbolic cosine epsilon divided by kBT. The entropy is minus df by dt. It's nk logarithm of 2 times hyperbolic cosine epsilon divided by kBT minus epsilon divided by kBT. Hyperbolic tangent of epsilon divided by kBT.
Excuse me, sir. I don't understand how Q becomes an analytic function on beta.
Well, if it's only 2 terms.
Only 2 terms.
If you have two terms here. So, if the spectrum is unbounded from above, the energy can be as big as you want. Then when you do this sum, you're not guaranteed to have an analytic function of beta. Using an infinite number of terms.
Okay.
If you have only 2 terms, you have 2 analytic functions, you get an analytic function. Okay. That's the thing. So if you have an infinite number of analytic functions, you might get not analytic function, but So in this case, it's e to the minus beta epsilon plus e to the plus beta epsilon. This is an analytic function. So it makes sense to consider. What does it mean? So this is what I'm trying to show. So this is the entropy, and this is the internal energy minus n epsilon, parabolic tangent of epsilon divided by kt. Now, if you look, now the entropy is a function of temperature, grows up to a maximum, which is log 2. Okay? So, as the temperature increases, the hyperbolic tangent goes to 1. But there is a 1 over t. So this disappears. The hyperbolic cosine... There is a log 2, and then the log of cosh minus this thing here will cancel. So you're left with log 2, which makes sense, right? Log 2 is, we have a system with two states. The entropy is the number of states, is the logarithm of the number of states in which your system can be. So the entropy grows from 0, because it's a logarithm of at zero temperature, we only have, the system is in the ground state. All the particles are in the ground state. So if we take the logarithm of 1, we get 0. So the entropy in zero temperature is 0. Okay? This sometimes is called the third law of thermodynamics. It's not true for all systems. There are systems that at zero temperature have a degeneracy of the ground state. For example, liquid crystals. The energy.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
In this case, if we just look as a on a different not physically, but if we just look at it, then at zero, it is constrained to be in the ground state.
Yes.
But at any t, there is possibility. So shouldn't it be a sharp state function? In some sense?
No, there is possibility, but it's not the number, the expected number of states doesn't jump from 1 to 2. It's a continuous function that interpolates between 1 and 2. Okay, so it doesn't count the exact number of states which are covered, the expected number of states. Okay. So it goes smoothly from 1, which is log 1, so from 0, which is log 1, to log 2. The energy goes from minus an epsilon, which is the ground state, to 0. Why 0? Because at infinite temperature, there is the same probability of occupying the state minus 1 half and the state plus 1 half. So if we plot the entropy as a function of... is a function of the internal energy, we get something like this. Okay? It's zero for internal energy being equal to minus an epsilon, and it's n log 2 for internal energy being equal to 0. We do the analytic continuation to negative temperatures, we can access a state in which the upper level is more populated than the lower level. This is called population inversion. So for any positive temperature, the probability that the ground state is the ground state is always more populated than the excited state. But for negative temperature, we obtain the opposite thing. And in this way, we can populate positive. We can get positive U's, and then this curve just reflects itself. And when we have temperature, so this is temperature 0 plus, this is temperature equal infinity, this is temperature equal 0 minus. Okay, so does it mean anything? It actually does, because in some experiments you can drive your system out of equilibrium and this out of equilibrium ensemble can be described by negative temperature. Okay? So if you have a system which is in equilibrium, which more particles are in the excited states than there are in the ground state, if you put it in contact with any bath, it will go down to the usual situation, in which the ground state is more populated than the first excited state. But if it's left isolated, then you can keep this. In general, in mathematics, it's just, you know, you consider this as a hyperbolic tangent of something which can be negative. There is nothing wrong with that, right? And the same you can do with the entropy. And in general, the entropy will be maximum at infinite temperature, irrespective of whether it's coming from the positive or negative. Because in this way you're just counting the number of states. Okay? Alright, that's up here for today. You have any questions? As I say, the negative temperature concept is very useful because you can use, I mean, it's not a physical temperature, it's something that can be measured by a thermometer, but it's a way in which you can force the system to have energy larger than the infinite temperature energy, which is when every state is populated with the same probability. Okay? So if I tell you I have a density matrix, okay, and this is the ground state, and this is the first excited state, and I populate this with probability 0.9, and this with probability 0.1, it's okay. But I can have a density matrix in which the ground state is populated with probability 0.1 and the excited state is probably populated with probability 0.9. This cannot be written in the form e to the minus beta h with the positive h. But it doesn't mean it doesn't exist. Okay? It's very difficult to maintain a many-body system in this kind of non-equilibrium situation, but, you know, in the experiments they can do it. And theoretically it makes sense to consider.
But to maintain this like this, there has to be aid from outside, or are there natural systems that do
it? Well, you need to not only eat, I mean, you don't have just to eat the system. If you eat the system, you increase the temperature.
No, I mean aid. Aid means help from outside.
Aid, yes. You need to...
Like,
what sometimes they do is they... They, you can have a way of depleting the population of the ground state. You start with with this thing here, but then you kill, like, you know, 99% of these things. So you just remove the particles which were in the ground state, and the first excited state was not touched by this, because sometimes, you know, different states in atomic systems, they couple differently to the electromagnetic field. Okay, so you can remove this thing, the population in the ground state, and left with few particles in the ground state and a lot of particles in excited states. And if you want to describe this statistically, you have to talk about negative temperature.
But they are generally lived shortly, or maybe can...
No, then you can have long-lived states, which are like this, such that you can talk about this non-equilibrium steady state kind of things. All right, let's stop here.